Hello, my name is Radu Moskov, and I would like to show you some of the wonders of the universe. Everybody, at one stage of his life, more or less, has lifted his eyes in the dark sky in the evenings and looked at the sky and looked at all of this amazing host of stars, planets, nebulas, and wondered where this beauty comes from. I'd like to show you some of this beauty and to encourage you also, you to carry on by your own, to carry on researching, to carry on studying and watching all the wonders of the cosmos, the universe, which are available to us. Let's imagine a quiet evening. The sun has just set. The skies are reddish on the horizon. We see the moon, we see the stars. And this tranquil feeling encourages us and sets us up to contemplate all of this beauty which is above us. It's certain times of the night, certain times in the year, we can see different constellations, different planets. And all of this inspires us with to think of something which is so beautiful and so nice and so ordered at the same moment, that we think of how can this beauty be so possible. Let's imagine that our day has just finished. The sun is just setting on the horizon. For the whole of this lecture, I would assume that we are in the northern hemisphere, in the moderate latitudes. So this is going to be our point of view. If we can imagine all of this, and of course, in the night, in the cities, the skies are polluted, and we've got too many lights which can prevent us from contemplating the details of heaven, which can be available for us in a night sky and out of town. But as you can see, the moon is shining. Some of the brightest stars are appearing near the horizon. There is Saturn and Mars. Little bit higher, we can start seeing bright stars like Arcturus. On the left side, we can see the Scorpion and his bright stars, Antares. And the stars never hurry and they are never late. They are just on time. We can learn a lot from the stars, from the sky above us. And I'd like this is actually to be the point of this presentation. You can see that Milky Way start appearing, and this is our galaxy. This bulge in the middle, in the constellation of Sagittarius and Scorpio, is the center of the galaxy, and you can see the sleeves. All of this beautiful picture can make us think as who made us and what's the meaning of our existence and where are we going, and can think about, and you can exclaim like the psalmist did in Psalms 19 verse 1 to 4, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttered speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech, no language, where their voice is not heard. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world." We can see order in every single corner of the galaxy, every single corner of the universe. And this order inspires us with to think that there is somebody that created all of this beauty. Let's imagine that we are 320 astronomical units away from the Sun, and just to tell you in the beginning, the distance in the astronomy is measured in different units. One of these units is astronomical unit, one astronomical unit, that being the distance between the Earth and the Sun, and that is 150 million kilometers. It will be very difficult to start writing big numbers, and this is why, especially in the parameters of the solar system, in a frame of solar system, we can think in astronomical units. So just imagine that we are watching the solar system 320 times the distance which the Earth rotates around the Sun. We are somewhere in a Kuiper belt, and we are watching back all the solar system. If we take the configurations of the planet and we come nearer, say 100 astronomical units, this is how the planets will look on the 25th of August, the year 2012. For the convenience, of course, I magnified the planets, otherwise they wouldn't be seen so nicely. If you can see the bigger planets from the right, Saturn with the ring, it's spectacular. The biggest planet, Jupiter, and then Uranus and Neptune, the last planet, the solar system. This is how the solar system will look if we don't magnify the planets, which I did. 100 astronomical units away. Say, for example, that's roughly the aphelion, or the remotest point of the orbit of Eris. Eris is the 10th planet, so called, if we assume that Pluto is the 9th planet, and actually Eris is bigger than Pluto and created a change in definition what the planet is. And in 2006, in August 2006, Eris, Pluto and all the planets, they have been discarded of their status. Actually, Eris has never been given the status of planet, just informally it's been given. And actually, Eris was the cause of rethinking and reshaping the definition of planet. For now, we've got only 8 planets, the last planet being Neptune. And this is how the solar system will look. You can see only few large bodies. You can see bright bodies, actually. You can see the Sun clearly. You can see Saturn and Jupiter being the biggest. Neptune and Uranus are dimly seen on this point. But this is what actually will look like if we are 100 astronomical units away. If we turn and if we make a video and if we take a year, almost a second, you can see how all this rotation is carrying on. You can see that the planets which are nearer to the Sun are rotating faster, while the planets which are far away are traveling slower in their orbits. If we take a careful look, you can see the inner planets are just spinning, while the outer planets it's proceeding slowly into orbit. The movement of the planets is very, very well defined through the science, through the ages. You can see Mercury is spinning around the Sun, then Venus, then the Earth, and the red planet Mars rotating around the Sun and their orbits. Now we are around 5 astronomical units away, or say, for example, in one of the satellites of Jupiter. Point now, if we go to the southern pole of the Sun, if we look at them from the bottom, we can see then the other point of view, and there is Jupiter zooming through the view. And the motions of the planets and all their movements have been the object of studies throughout the ages, and they inspired a lot of scientists to take their studies, their researches. On this picture we can see a little speck. You can see down the bottom a reddish ray, and in the middle of this reddish ray you can see a small bluish whitish speck, and this is actually how the Earth looks when Voyager left the solar system, and this is how the Earth actually will look like, a little speck in the universe. But let's go back in our solar system and let's start studying some of the wonders of the solar system by contemplating all of this beauty. Let's go to the last planet. The last planet is called Neptune. Neptune's orbit takes 164 years to complete. So 1 year in Neptune lasts 164 Earth years. So to complete his slow movement around the Sun, it will take him 164 years. Neptune is the last planet of the solar system, if we don't include, of course, the small planets, which some of them we mentioned before. It rotates around the Sun in a orbit approximately 4.5 billion kilometers. Talking about 4.5 billion kilometers. Or 30 times the distance between the Earth and the Sun. Neptune's bluish color is caused by the gases which are present in its atmosphere. Of course, it's quite cold place. Neptune also boasts the fastest winds in the solar system. We're talking about 2 times the speed of sound, or approximately 2,300 kilometers per hour winds. It's such ferocious winds on this planet. Neptune is approximately 50 times bigger than the Earth and has several satellites. The interesting thing about Neptune is that it's discovered in the year 1846 by pure mathematical research and calculations. The French scientist Le Verrier observed some disturbances of the orbit of the previous the seventh planet Uranus, and came into the conclusion that such disturbances can be caused only by a bigger body who stands behind the orbit of Uranus. And doing these calculations, he made the predictions where the planet will be, and lo and behold, within 1 degree, that means between the diameters of 2 full moons, the planet was discovered, and that was the triumph of science. It's actually the first planet discovered by mathematical calculations. And consequent observations, and by using the logical method of the remnants, that means if you know everything else but you don't know the reason, you can't find the reason is when you take out all that you know and the remnant, the residue, is what is the reason of death. So Le Verrier knew the orbit of Uranus, because Uranus has been discovered in 1781, so it's 65 years earlier. So the orbit was very well known, and calculating the disturbances and seeing the residue, what is left after we know everything. The reason of this residue and this remainder is the reason of existence of bigger planet. This bigger planet has been called Neptune. Okay, this is how Neptune will look if we are in one of his satellites, Triton.
Even on the left bottom corner, you can see the constellation of the Ursa Major or the Big Dipper.
Okay, this is how the solar system will look if we look back from a Neptune. Look at the left upper corner. You can see some bright stars grouped together. It's not actually stars, it's the planets, and in the middle there is the sun. On the left you can see two of his satellites, Triton and the other satellites. And in the middle again the solar system. You can see in the middle you can see the Milky Way. The center part of the Milky Way. Neptune has several satellites. Who we're watching actually this from the surface of Triton, and you can see them actually rotating around each other. It's a magnificent view. If there is a chance that one day humans can go there and can see this view, it's unearthly and unthinkable view. It's so beautiful. If we have to move 1.5 billion kilometers nearer to the sun, we'll find a very strange planet, the planet Uranus, with its pale bluish color. It's also quite cold. The year of Uranus is 84 years, earthly years. So he completes one of his revolutions around the sun for 84 years. Also has several satellites. The interesting thing is that he had a faint ring, and the ring was discovered when Uranus was eclipsing one of the further stars. There was a actually the ring eclipsed some of the stars and caused different shift in the spectrum. The astronomers were thinking that there should be a ring, and the ring was also discovered when and you can see it when Voyager passed around. The funny thing about Uranus is that Uranus is actually rolling around his orbit like a ball will roll. If you hit the ball will roll. It's not spinning on its axis like the Earth, almost vertical. It's rolling, and if you can see on this video what I mean, it's very clear. On this video you can see the equator in the red, this red strip. You can see also the poles, the northern pole, the planet in dark blue, and the southern pole in the red where the axis is. And you can see how it's rolling. And the funny thing is that one half of the planet, it's lit by the sun for 42 years. You can see especially the pole for 42 years. You've got sunlight, and then for 42 years you've got full darkness. You can imagine one of the sides being very hot and the other side very cold. And in the middle, you can imagine what kind of hurricanes will be there. Nevertheless, Neptune holds the palm of first place, holds the first place of the speed of winds. So this is Uranus. Now imagine if our Earth was like this, if the Earth had 42 years day and 42 years night, what kind of storms and what kind of variations in the climate and all of this will cause. And we can see here God's design also to place our planet in the right place and to give it the right spin and the right inclination of the axis. This is how Uranus will look after Voyager left the vicinity of the planet for Neptune. We can never see this from the Earth because the Earth is always way ahead of Uranus. This is we're talking about. It's 20 astronomical units is the distance, and because the Earth is just one astronomical unit, we can never see Uranus or the outside planets, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, in this way. In order you to see this, you need to be behind the planet, not in front of the planet, like the Earth is. Saturn has excited people from the time that they were in a position to watch it through the telescope, of course, with its spectacular ring. Most of the bodies of the ring are not bigger than the human head, but there are so many stones and ice rotating at it. From the Earth we see them as a solid body. It's quite thin and it gives, of course, Saturn his unique view. Saturn is also quite a cold planet. It is approximately 10 times 10 astronomical units, or 10 times the distance from the Earth to the Sun. We're talking about 1.5 billion kilometers. It's unthinkable distance. It has more than 60 satellites. And this is actually how big is Saturn compared to the Earth. The interesting thing about Saturn is the lightest planet of the solar system. It means of the cosmos, of the space was water, only Saturn will float on top of water because it's lighter even than the water. That means his average density, we're talking average density, because in the center of Saturn there is a quite dense core, which is much denser than the density of water, of course, but his average density is less than 1 gram per cubic centimeter. So because it's less dense than the water, it will float if the planet could be immersed in water, so to say. You can see the sizes of Saturn compared to the Earth. It's the second biggest planet after Jupiter, and it's also a gas giant like Uranus, Neptune, and Jupiter. It's a gas giant. It's mostly hydrogen, methane, and other gases. And if you can see the picture, you can see one of his satellites. That's Mimas. And if you can see this artist impression, this is how Saturn will look rising of you in one of his satellites. It will take half of the sky, and it will be amazing just to watch it. It will be brighter than the sun, actually, because the sun is quite distant from there, but the space which Saturn takes is quite big in the sky, so it will illuminate then with much higher intensity than the sun itself. If we're in one of his satellites, Rhea, this is what actually we're gonna watch one to one. Rhea is one of the satellites. We're gonna see these little stars rotating around Saturn. Not stars, yeah, it's satellites. This is what you're gonna see. You're gonna see the ring quite thin, because most of his satellites are rotating in the plane of the equator of Saturn, and this is what actually we're gonna see. The next planet, the fifth planet, it's 750 million kilometers away from the Sun, or 5 astronomical units. Take his revolution around the Sun for approximately 12 Earth years. It's the biggest of the planets. It's the giant of the solar system. Actually, it can take all other planets of the solar system and fit them inside, and there will be still space. We're talking about all of the seven planets. If we put them inside Jupiter, there will be still space. Such a huge planet. Okay, you can see stormy clouds, and one of the biggest storms, the famous red spot. You can see it in the right corner. You can see different storms there, different colors. It's created by the composition of different gases. If we compare Jupiter to the Earth, you can see what we're talking about. How big this, how huge is this planet? It's actually, you can fit 1,300 Earths into Jupiter. Also has more than 60 satellites. In the picture we can see a few of them. From the left we see Ganymede, then Europe on the right, the icy satellite, and then near Jupiter you can see Io, or Io, depends what you prefer. A very stormy atmosphere. You can see again the red spot and some white spots. Yeah, it's areas of storms and hurricanes there. Also, a satellite Io has been quite volcanically active. This volcanic activity is caused by its proximity. It's actually the nearest satellite of the four big satellites, or Galilean satellites. It's the nearest of these four, and when it rotates, the tidal forces creates friction, which friction releases heat, and this heat melts the rocky substances in its interior, and some of this rocky substance being melted goes on the surface. It's quite volcanically active. Jupiter is also on a very special place on the solar system. Now, when God creates anything, he doesn't create it just casually and puts them in a space just like this. He creates everything and puts it in its exact space. Being the largest planet, of course, will exercise the largest gravitational pull on everything around around itself, and it's actually put in the right place, because if Jupiter wasn't there, all the comets and asteroids which are headed for the Earth could hit us very much often than if Jupiter wasn't there. The presence of Jupiter, of course, prevents this, and Jupiter takes them into his orbit, and in cases of comets, like this comet, Shoemaker-Levy, as you know, 1994, collided with Jupiter. If you can see in this video of ESA, first the comet was disintegrated in a small pieces, pulled apart by the strong gravitational pull of Jupiter, and then start collision. Bang, bang, bang. One of these collisions, it's such a magnitude that the power released by the collision, it's incredible. We need to thank God for Jupiter, because if Jupiter wasn't there, if you can imagine if this could happen to the Earth. Look at just the spots. One of these spots, if you remember the picture, the Jupiter, how small the Earth was compared to this. One of these spots is bigger than the Earth itself. And so if you can imagine this explosion happening to Earth, it will obliterate all the life on Earth. You can see part of the pieces of this comet fall on the satellite Ganymede. It's actually the largest satellite in the solar system. So Jupiter exercises his gravitational pull on everything that can be dangerous for the Earth, and that in this way can save us a lot of trouble. The next planet also has been inspiring scientists and writers, and that's the planet Mars.
Mars is orbiting the Sun in orbit approximately 225 million kilometers.
75 million kilometers away. We're talking at the average, but can go very near. Can go as near as 50 million kilometers. And this time the Mars is quite near. In this video you can see the Mars with his satellite Phobos. Phobos is spinning around Mars so much that because his orbit around Mars is very, very fast, you can see it actually rising on the west and setting on the east. It's around 25 kilometers big. It's not a big thing. It's very difficult to observe. And you can see different features in this in the face of Mars. These features has been taken as evidence of life, because some people assumed the incorrect translation of Schiaparelli's Italian canale. They translated as a channels, thinking, well, there is a water there. If there is a channels, should be a water, and if there is a water and channels, of course there is intelligent life. But that's not the case. Though the Mars is a rocky planet as the Earth, its atmosphere is quite thin. It's only 1% of the pressure of the Earth's atmosphere. It's carbon dioxide, and of course you watched lately the incredible transmissions which Curiosity sent to the Earth. There is his two satellites, Phobos and Deimos. Mars in the Greek mythology was the deity for the war, and of course his satellites given proper name fear and horror. Phobos, fear, and Deimos, horror. Now Schiaparelli actually, in order to see the channels and all of these features in Mars. In 19th century, spent hour in completely dark room so that the pupil of his eye can open and can see more details. And this is one of the things that are interesting in astronomy, that in order to see more details in what you're watching, you need to be in an area which is not polluted by the light pollution. And the light, of course, must the night must be moonless. The air must be far from the cities so that you can observe nice things, and your eyes can be must be strong, and you can use a good instrument. Me and my family, we have a telescope, and we enjoy watching all of the wonders, the sky that can be offered to us in the different seasons, in the different months. And of course, before we watch, we shut off all the lights at night. The area where we stay is relatively not polluted, and is actually a pleasure watching it. And if we come to the third planet from the sun, this is our home planet, Earth. It's unique. It's unique all around you watching it. It has a blue nitrogen skies. You got oceans full of water, which is crucial for the proliferance of life in the Earth. And his atmosphere is transparent. It's not cloudy like the atmosphere of the other planets. So God created transparent so that you can watch the skies, and we can wander, and we can, like the Bible says, see the Creator, even though he's not far from us. The wonders of the Creator is so obvious when we watch the sky that we can exclaim with awe and thankfulness and gratitude for all of these wonderful creations. But the most amazing thing is that, like Einstein says it, the most incomprehensible thing of the universe is that the universe is comprehensible. So that God created us also a brain so that we can appreciate all of these wonders that surround us. The Earth is placed on the right, exactly right place in the solar system. If it was like Mars, you see how Mars looks like, it's quite cold planet. If it was little bit further on, it will be so hot that the water could just boil out. We also have ozone layer, which stops the water molecule going further in the sky and disintegrating by the ultraviolet light. Just the right thing on the right place. Now, I always say that if you find 9 bottles on the beach just scattered, you'll say, well, somebody scattered them. But if you find them ordered, like 3 by 3 in a perfect square, you can't say that somebody ordered them. You always think somebody actually take time and order them properly, not just happen by itself. And if you can see how the Earth is positioned in its orbit, in its place in the solar system, and the composition of the Earth, and all the miracles, they are not 90, more than billions if you start counting them. And one of the biggest wonder of all the Earth is the existence of the humankind, with having perceptions and having the brain to appreciate all of this beauty. Though some people don't appreciate it, and this is why the Bible says the fool says in his heart there is no God. There is no way that you can watch all of this and staying indifferent to it and to its beauty, and saying that just all of this created itself in the right place in the right time. It's too much to say that. And if somebody can create this, imagine this someone, how big should be, so that he can be able to create such a big and wonderful things. The Earth also as a very exact rotation. It's 365 days and a quarter around the sun. Its axis is tilted 23 degrees towards the ecliptic. He has a very quite large satellite, the moon, which is rotating for 29 and a half days around the Earth. If the moon wasn't there, Earth's axis wouldn't be so stable, and then that will be catastrophical on a climate of the Earth. Can you imagine one time the winter is in January, then the other time in July? What kind of vegetation can be supportive of that kind of climbing? So we need to think God about the moon also, because by its pull, the moon is
stabilizing the axis of the Earth, and therefore its rotation.
It's the second main cause being the sun, and if the tides didn't exist also, there will be a quite different Earth than what we know now. Also, as you can see, the moon's only one side of the moon is turned around the Earth, and though the moon shows different phases, if we watch it throughout the moon, it's the only one phase that's turned around us, and this is due of the fact that the Earth's gravitation pulls this side so that the moon cannot be spinning around itself like the Earth, for example, does. It's actually the Earth gravitation stops all of this spinning, and only one side of the moon is turned around it. Also, another people will say coincidence, but think about what a coincidence could be that.
The moon.
The visual diameter, it's around half a degree. It's exactly the same as the visual diameter of the sun. And because the Earth, the moon is 400 times smaller than the sun. We're talking about the diameter of the moon is 400 times smaller than the sun, but the moon is 400 times nearer. They look exactly the same in the sky. So this is why the eclipses are possible. Otherwise, there wouldn't be eclipses. And the eclipses had very strong, very big scientific importance. If there were not eclipses, we could not study the solar corona, and we could not discover, say, for example, the element helium, and we could not study the spectrum of the sun, and this was actually the thrust where the spectrum of the stars starts getting studied. So the moon is quite significant in for us. This is how the full moon will look through a telescope. This other picture I took. And you can see there is a few craters there, because the moon is almost in the same line. So that means towards the sun and the Earth. So we're watching the full moon. There is no shadows, you can see. You can see some dark spots. They call them seas or maria in Latin, though there is no water in the moon. But this is how they've been called. You got some big impacts. And this is another picture which I took with our telescope. On this you can see crater on the termin, or on the line between the light and the shadow of the moon, or the day and night. You can see some mountains, you can see some impacts, and this is why you couldn't see them on the previous picture, because on the previous picture the sun was shining just, so call it on the noon above the moon. This is why there is no shadows, while at this side you can see it on the line of the sunset. You can see a lot of craters just in the Earth. You can see exactly the same. During sunset, the shadows are the longest. Some coincidence, in brackets, I would say, is about the moon also. So if we can see all of these things that are ordered, we couldn't say that just somebody ordered, it happened just like this. Of course, somebody ordered them. Just look at it. It takes 27.32 days for the moon to complete a full rotation around its axis and around Earth, because they are identical by time. If you measure this period towards the distant stars. But because the Earth is also turning around the Sun, it takes little but longer, 29.5 days for the line of the Moon, Earth and the Sun to be exactly the same like the previous time, or the face of the Moon to be exactly the same. So if we take the first month you tested, which is called sidereal month, 27.32 days. If you divide it into one, we are getting 0.0366. Or if we divide it into 10,000, or you divide 10,000 by 27.32, it's 366 days. And this is actually 366 days is our year. So how can be possible that our year can be measured by the moon's orbit? More than that, if you divide 10,000 being 100 by 100, if you divide 10,000 by 366, you're getting again the same number, 27.32. So both of these numbers in mathematics, they call them reciprocal numbers. And it's quite amazing how that the moon period of rotation signifies the Earth's rotation around the Sun. More than that, the diameter of the moon is 0.273 of the diameter of the Earth. The acceleration of the moon on its orbit, because you know by the laws of Newton that all bodies that are rotating are accelerating, is 0.273 centimeters per square second. Maybe another coincidence, I wouldn't say. 0 degree Kelvin, or absolute zero, is minus 273 degrees Celsius. That could be a coincidence, maybe. Again, the number 273. Gases expand with 1/273 of their volume every grade. The baby to be born is necessary to have 273 days, and 273 days is just 10 sidereal moon months by 10. Now that was not enough. Take another consideration. If you take a square, which side is the diameter of circle, if you cut the circle from the square, the remaining parts is 0.273 or 27.3% of the whole. So if you take a square, which side is the exact diameter of the circle, and you fit them into each other, and if you cut the circle from the square, the remaining part will be 0.2732 from the circle. So it's maybe another coincidence. It doesn't look like. And as you know, the Earth is rotating around the Sun for a little bit more than 365 days, and her actual tilt is around 23 degrees, and this is the reasons for the season. As you can see, the red line across the Earth is the equator of the Earth. This plane is the plane where the Earth is rotating around the Sun, or the ecliptic. It's called ecliptic because if the Moon is only and only on this space, then the eclipse can occur. You've got the North Pole and you've got the South Pole, blue and red, as you can see. Now there is the summer on the southern hemisphere. Now the days are equal. Then you've got summer in the northern hemisphere, as you can see how exposed is it, while the southern hemisphere is in darkness. I believe that before the flood, there wasn't such a tilt, and the Earth was maybe just straight. So this is why you couldn't have a places in Earth where you've got 6 months night and 6 months day, like the northern or the southern pole, and the climate was more moderate. That's the thing. Now, on this picture, you can see the Earth on the 23rd of March. You can see both of the poles are seen. That means the Sun in every point on the Earth is rising exactly on the east and setting exactly on the west, and all around the Earth, you day and night being equal for 12 hours. There's the Earth on the 22nd of June. You can see the Earth in this position where the northern hemisphere is tilted towards the Sun, while the southern hemisphere is away from the Sun. You can see the southern pole is dark. Again, 22nd of September, you've got both poles. Again, you can see both poles, means again the same situation like in the spring, called the equinox. That means day and nights are equal. And 22nd of December, the North Pole is dark. You can see only the southern pole. The plane is the ecliptic. But now, if you want to see how the Earth is rotating, if the north is north and the south is south, this is what you're gonna see. Again, you've got all the points of the equinoxes and the solstices, but just you can see the of everything was according to the north south on the Earth. Now you can see the south hemisphere lighten up, then equinox. Then you've got the northern hemisphere lightened up, and then you've got again another equinox. If we want to see how the planets are looking at night, and we'd like to pick up just some situation of the planets in their orbit, you can see the Earth in the middle of the picture, and you can see the planet Saturn on the right and Jupiter on the left. You can see a little small circle, that's Mars, and you can see some Venus even. Of course, the planets are magnified in order to see them. But if this is the configuration, everything on the left of the picture is what we're gonna see in the evening, while everything on the right side of the picture is what we're gonna see on the morning. So you can see Saturn exactly on opposite side of the dark side of the Earth. That means you're gonna see it throughout all the night. It's called opposition. This is how you're gonna see Saturn if you look at it in a telescope with 2000 times magnification. Normally we don't see this with naked eye. And this is how you're gonna see the rest of the planets. The Mars and Jupiter you can see on the left. That means you're gonna see it immediately on the sunset, and on the right you see Venus, Mercury and Neptune. You can see, and that's gonna be seen in the morning. Of course, such a picture you can't see from the Earth. This is because first the Sun is gonna blot out all the sky. You can't see planets with the rare exception of Venus, which is when is the brightest. And actually Venus is the brightest heavenly body after the Sun and the Moon. You can see another phenomenon here is that all the outer planets, Mars, Jupiter and Saturn, this is actually the planets that you can see with the naked eye, with a very rare exception of Uranus, where if you've got very strong eyes and if you're in such a pristine conditions, then you can see also Uranus. It's very dim, 5.8 magnification planet, and you can see them with the full face, while the inner planets Mercury and Venus, you can see that their face are not full, and actually you can't see them with a full face because they're on the other side of the Sun, and because they're inside of our orbit, we can always see them in a different stages of phases, while the outer planets you can see only in a full phase. The reason being is the angular distance from the Sun is always not so high, and because of this they can be seen very near towards sunset or sunrise. For example, Mercury's maximal elongation or the angular distance from the Sun is 27.8 degrees, and Venus is 47 degrees. That means you can't see both planets in the middle of the night. Middle of the night being the on this side of the opposite side, because the inner planets you cannot see them on the outer side of the Earth. Therefore, in the midnight you can't see them. If you can see in this picture, the orange line is the horizon, and this is the distance. If we turn all the pictures so that you can imagine it, there is a little man there standing on a horizon. You can see Mercury only on the maximum on 27.8 degrees, and Venus maximum 47 degrees. So few hours after sunset you can see the maximum, but not in the middle of the night. This is how they're gonna look if you look them from the Earth and not from the space as we took picture, and that's we're talking about maximum and elongation. Of course you're not gonna see them like this. This is again, I would say, 2000 times magnification, but you can see them as bright stars on the left side of the picture. Of the right of their orbits from the Earth, then you're gonna see them in a morning before the Sun rises. Another phenomenon in Earth is because the Earth is around, you may wonder why. If you go, say, in the southern hemisphere, you're gonna see the Moon and all the constellations, which can be seen upside down. The reason is very simple. Exactly because the Earth is round, you're gonna see it turned upside down. This is the constellation Orion, and the big Canis Majoris, the big dog, and the Moon is seen from the northern hemisphere on the 26th of December 2012. You can see also near the Moon brightest star Aldebaran, and nearer you can see the orange. That's orange dot is Jupiter. This is how actually you're gonna see it. If you go on the southern hemisphere, say in South Africa, you're gonna see all the things upside down, like in this picture. If I help you a little, but if I make the lines of the constellations, if you can see them, this is how you're gonna see in the northern hemisphere, in the place of Varna. Now, if you go in South Africa in Port Shepstone, see, you're gonna see them upside down in this way. The reason is because the Earth is round. If you see the yellow man there, his top and his directions of top and up and down, top and bottom, are different than the one that is in South Africa and Port Jefferson, the brown one. Of the line is the horizon, and the arrow shows the direction up. And if we have a hypothetical number one written in the sky, the one written in white, both of them, that they see one object, they're gonna see it in different position. The yellow man, you're gonna see it a little bit tilted, as you can see there, while the brown man, you're gonna see it completely upside down, also, but tilted. And if you go further down to the southern pole, you're gonna see it absolutely upside down. Or you go to the pole, to the northern pole, you're gonna see it absolutely straight up. So this is actually the reason. On the northern pole, say, for example, another interesting phenomena occurs is that the sun never sets for 6 months and turns around the horizon for the whole day and night, as you can see. And this is the during the summer, it's just sun, so the sun turns and turns. During the 6 months night, you can see the stars doing the same. They just go around the horizon. Now, if we have to go to again to our back position at night, and you can see the constellations and the sky and the Milky Way and the different stars. Some of them are blinking. Some of them are different colors. Some of them are not blinking, some of them are dim, some of them are quite bright. And from the old ancient days, the people start grouping the stars in a different pattern, like this one. You can see quite familiar pattern, and the other one as well, which we'll name them just now. And these patterns in different nations are sometimes different, but the important point is that the humankind thought it necessary to group the star in certain figures so that they can get orientated by them and know the sky. In a cloudless night, you can see maybe with naked eye 2,000-3,000. In a moonless night, you can see maybe 2,000-3,000 stars, and you can see also the planets. If you know where you can find them, different shapes and different figures of the sky prompted the people to call them with different names and to associate them with different kind of figures. Most of them come from the ancient Greek literature and the mythology, where they called the constellation according to their beliefs. And they associated all of these figures in the skies with the different names. You can see snakes, you can see different birds, you can see people, you can see bears, you can see quite a different things in the sky. The sky has been separated in different areas in 1922. And all the constellations area has been given names. The names are quite interesting. The French astronomer Lalande proposed even for one of the constellations to be called Cat. As you can see, the sky is rotating. Some of the stars are rising, some of them are setting, some of them are not moving. And you can see one of the star, actually, which is not moving, is the polar star, straight on the right top corner. And some of them are just turning around that star. You can see them all the night, while some of them are setting and rising. And the constellation names are Very interesting how did they come. You don't need to look at absolutely perfect patterns. In some constellations you can't even see a pattern of certain things, but nevertheless they've been named. So you can see the constellation, say for example of the shield, Scutum in Latin, which the Polish astronomer Hevelius gave it in honor of his king Sobieski. You can see different names. Well, the great geographical discoveries has been done, of course, in different names of the constellations has been given, like Microscopium, Telescopium, Sextant, and different other names, which before was not not people are not familiar from the Northern Hemisphere. They are not familiar with them, so they gave them contemporary names. Also, Hevelius gave names to another constellation of Lynx. Where he says you need to have eyes for Lynx to see it, and the stars are quite dim. But Hevelius also says, look, if you want to call it the other name, just call it. I'm not insistent on that name. Some of the stars are named, most of them are named actually in Arabic, like Aldebaran, Almitak, Betelgeuse, Deneb. All of them are Arabic names, because the Arabic astronomers is naming these stars and we accept them. One of the stars in Hunting Dogs or Canes Venetici has the name of Cor Caroli. And British astronomer Scarborough called it in honor of the beheaded King Charles. Cor Caroli meaning the heart of Charles. So this is the names of the constellations. For example, Ursa Major or the Big Bear doesn't look like a Big Bear if you look at it. You just look at the big, deeper, but to have a figure of a bear out of these stars is Bayer in 1604 in his magnum opus Uranometria. That is going to be almost impossible, but nevertheless the ancient Greeks name it in this way, and the name stays there. Dolphinus, you may make a figure of dolphin out of these stars. Scorpio, yes, Scorpio is one of the biggest constellation in the sky, and you actually can figure out the figure of the Scorpius out of this. I think it's not so difficult. Well, other constellations are not so easy to discern out of the sky the different figure by which they are called, and you shouldn't look for an exact representation. It's just a name. A is the Scorpius in the sky. We're looking at it in the Northern Hemisphere. Scorpius and Sagittarius constellations, where part of the sky is the center of the galaxy. As you can see, the bulge in the middle. If you look at the sky looks like a screen, as if you're looking at like in the screen, but in reality it's not a screen. The stars are a different distance from us. Say for example, again we'll take for example Scorpius. You're looking at like in the flat screen, but actually the stars are in a different distance from us, and because of the huge distance from us, we are seeking order positions them in a flat surface. It's actually the function of our brain. Constellation of Leo, the lion, also the same. The stars look like the figure of a lion, But the stars actually are quite different distance from us. If you look also at this picture, down at the bottom you'll see the double star, Dabih. And on the top you can see another double star, Prima Gedi and Seconda Gedi. Both of the stars are quite different, a quite different distance from us. Prima Gedi is only 150 light years, while Seconda Gedi is 605 light years. So the distance between them is much bigger than the distance from Prima Gedi to us, but we perceive them as a double star. And this is what I'm saying, is that though the stars look near to each other, sometimes the distances between them is quite high. If you look at a line in this animation, if you look at the, if we take a travel to the star Regulus, you can see how the stars and the lines between them are distorted. If we have to come back, they're gonna come in space. You can see that they don't stay in the same position if you have to take a ride to Regulus. That means the stars are not into the same difference. The studies of the skies in Europe during medieval ages has been confined between the walls of the church, and the church has imposed certain dogmatic views on that based on the wrong constructions of Aristoteles and Ptolemaeus. Just in 15th and 16th century, when the Polish astronomer Copernicus lived, he started studying the skies with deep intensity and came into the idea that the geocentric system, which was proposed and enforced by the church as a major dogma, till this moment is actually not the true reflection of the reality. And Copernicus proposed the heliocentric system, or the sun to be in the center of the rotation of the planets. Though before Copernicus, Heraclitus and Aristarchus in ancient Greece proposed this model, the model of Aristoteles, of the geocentric model, was accepted widely, later confirmed in the works of Ptolemaeus in the first and the second century AD. Copernicus wrote his work De Revolutionis Celis Orbis, or for the about the revolutions of the heavenly bodies. Because the official position was totally the opposite, he printed it actually, and he published it much later in his life, and he actually prohibited printing the book while he was alive. And the story goes that the book was printed and it was given to him on his deathbed, and he actually saw it. This book revolutionized the views. Many people start reading it and saw the scientific evidences on the fact that the dogma was not the what's the real thing about the solar system. And many of the scientists paid for this with their life. Giordano Bruno in the year 1600 was burnt alive naked on a stake because of this belief, of course, many other beliefs. But you can see how strongly a wrong belief can influence the life of many people and cost the life even of scientists. And and people who'd like to know the truth. And this is no, he wasn't the first one to be burned on a stake because of holding to the truth. And for us, it's also very important we to know that the truth is not something that we can trifle with, and you can see that the truth about these things, about the cosmos which we have available for us now, is not something that came out of nothing. It cost the life of many people. Another brilliant scientist, Galileo Galilei, which is a universal scientist. He was a physician, mathematician, and astronomer. He actually made the first telescope. Well, Dutch scientists made the telescope, but he was just a children's toy. Though you can magnify the image, it wasn't good for scientific observation and any practical use. Well, Galileo take a lot of time to make this telescope. Can you imagine polishing all the lenses to make it nice and proper for viewing? And in this picture you can see Galileo showing it to the Doge of Venetia. In the beginning, the telescope was used by merchants. They wanted to see which ship is coming and what cargo is bringing, so that they can be 2-3 hours ahead of time of other merchants, so that they can sell fast their wares and cash in bigger profit. As you can see, the science is driven by business again. Also, Venetian Navy commissioned Galileo to make a few telescope, and he was quite famous at this stage. There is his telescope. He made observations, and this is actually the his handwriting way he made observation. Actually, he made the terrible evil to point his telescope to the sky, which was strictly forbidden by the church at that stage, and because the church has the full authority of enlightening the people about the heavens, and looking at the sky with the telescope, it was a terrible heresy and something that was quite punishable. But he took the chance and look at it, and lo and behold, when he pointed to the planet Jupiter, he saw, as you can see, I just cut clips out of his work and pasted on the view. If we take the 7th of January 610, this is what he observed, and this is what he wrote in his diary. He saw Jupiter, and he saw three bright stars around him. This is his satellites. They looked three though the nearest one, they're near to each other, so he saw them as three. On the 8th, he saw again three of satellites, though they're four of the biggest satellites of Jupiter, because the fourth, Callisto, is quite on the left. On the 13th, again, he looked at Jupiter and saw four satellites. This is the first time where Galileo saw all of the four satellites. On the 14th of January, it was cloudy, so he looked again on the 15th and again confirmed four satellites of Jupiter. This is the position of Jupiter and his satellites. Europa, Callisto, and Ganymede. This is what Galileo couldn't see, though he saw the movement around the planet, as you can see on the different dates. They are moving around the planet, and at this stage the dogma was that everything is rotating around the Earth. The Earth is immovable, and everything is rotating around the Earth. So what Galileo saw and what we think at the moment is the rotating of satellites of Jupiter around Jupiter. And that's something that was not admissible by the church. The church says that everything is rotated around the Earth. For first time, Galileo saw something that's rotating around something else. The leading scientist at this age scornfully rejected the idea that the Earth is rotating around the Sun by the argument that if the Earth is rotating around the Sun, how can the Moon rotates around the Earth? The Moon is going to lag behind. And the first time Galileo disproved this theory by seeing that the moons of Jupiter is rotating around Jupiter without lagging behind. It's the same argument that if you say that if you travel in a public bus and if you jump, you're gonna leave behind. No, you've got still the movement of the bus, the inertia. This is why, though the Earth is rotating, when you jump in the air, you're not falling 30 meters behind because the Earth is rotating, because you've got the inertia of the moving with the Earth. So this is the reason how we can see the things. But what he saw in the telescope create havoc. This is the first visual proof of the Copernicus heliocentric system. And I can see it with your own eyes. Also, he observed the inner planets, Venus and Mercury, and he saw them that they've got phases, while the outer planets don't have phases. And this is actually even greater proof, because only of the Earth is rotating around the Sun, and the planets Venus and Mercury are inner planets, and the Sun stays in the middle, you can see phases. Otherwise, you can't see the phases as you can see them from now. You saw also craters on the Moon. You saw the ring of Saturn. And for all of this, the church was not very happy, and they called him on trial, though the Pope Urban VIII was in the beginning his friend, and he allowed Galileo to entertain his views as a hypothetical alternative of the official view, but nothing else. So he was brought into trial. He perfectly well knew what happened to Giordano Bruno, and he didn't want to finish like him, naked on a stake, burnt alive. So though he exposed the error of the church in writing, he actually wrote it in a plain Italian so everybody can read. In his work Dialogues of the Two Great Systems of the World, he writes about this, and the church was not very happy, especially where the Pope was covertly ridiculed, and the church officials were not happy with all of it. They brought him into trial. He recanted. He didn't stay stubbornly to his views like Giordano Bruno, and the church offered him much less attention than in the case of Giordano Bruno. They didn't sentence him to be burnt alive, but sentenced him to lifetime house arrest. So he stays in his house till the rest of his life. He couldn't move much out except going Sunday to church. But the church wasn't happy with his views, because he disproved their beliefs and exposed their errors. Their point was that even the Holy Scripture says that the Earth is immovable. And they used several scriptures for that. Say Psalms 93:1, the Lord reigned, he is clothed with majesty, the Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he had girded himself, the world also established it, he cannot be moved. So the Bible says that the world cannot be moved. Galileo came into the point, also came across this verse, because the Inquisition helpfully offered him these verses for his perusal. Also Psalms 33 verse 9, for he spake and it was done, he commanded and it stood fast. How can something that stood fast moves, like he assumes to say? In Ecclesiastes 1 verse 5 it says, the sun also arises and the sun goes down, and he hasted to his place where he arose. So the sun hastes, not the earth, according to this interpretation of the Bible. In Psalm 104 verse 5 it says, who laid the foundation of the earth that it should not be removed forever, not just for a day or for a year, forever the earth should not be removed. Galileo argued that, like in the book of Ecclesiastes and in the book of Psalms, the Bible should not be interpreted always literally, but there is always figurative meaning, like say for example Psalms 44 verse 23, arise God, why thou sleepest. The Lord doesn't sleep. This is what Isaiah 40:28 says to us. But the Bible uses also figurative languages, and Galileo argued that this is actually figurative language and it should not be interpreted literally, and he was right on this point. Though he suffered, he didn't die, and he carried on with his scientific contribution to the humankind. Just late in the 20th century, the Pope John Paul offered a formal apology. He wrote, so, thanks to his intuition as a brilliant physicist and by relying on different arguments, Galileo, who practically invented the experimental method, understood why only the sun could function as the center of the world, as it was then known. That is to say, as a planetary system. The error of the theologians of the time, when they maintained the centrality of the earth, was to think that our understanding of the physical world structure was in some way imposed by the literal sense of the scripture. The Guardian writes in this issue of 13th of March, seeking forgiveness has been a leitmotif of his papacy since his election of 1978. He was apologized for the Crusades, for the massacres of French Protestants, the trial of Galileo, and anti-Semitism. Yesterday's apology was by far the most sweeping and the unprecedented act for the leader of major religion. One of the highlights of this year's Jubilee or Holy Year, it was the result of 4 years' research by a panel of 28 theologians and scholars. The Guardian writes, the problem is that the problem is that the Pope is as his assumed title of Vicar of the Son of God, he is infallible, and for example, Urban VIII condemned the works of Galileo. That means that's an infallible decision, and it should be supported. And the problem starts, how do you disprove an infallible decision? This is why it took 28 theologians and 4 years to come with the decision that no, the earth is rotating around the sun, not vice versa. So this is actually the major problem, was the doctrine of the infallibility of the pontifex, of the Pope. The Pope wasn't maintaining the infallibility, it would have been much easier. If we have to again observe the movement, the rotation of the earth around the sun, we're gonna see that throughout the year the sun is moving into different constellations. And this constellation has been called zodiacal constellation, from Zeus, in ancient Greek meaning animal, you can see the 12 different constellations. Most of them are animals, like Pisces, Aries, Taurus, the Bull, Cancer, the Crab, Leo, the Lion, and Scorpius, the Scorpion. This is why it's called the zodiacal constellations from those animals. You can see the Sun is moving throughout the year through these constellations, and if you project a line from the Earth to the Sun to the constellations, you're going to see them passing throughout the different, and the line throughout all the constellations, this circle, red circle, is called the ecliptic. Of course, you can't see the Sun going into the different constellation with your naked eye, because it's, the sky is just washed out blue. But if you could have seen it, you'll be able to see it, how throughout the year the Sun passes through these constellations. They are the constellations. And you can see how throughout the year the Sun is passing through all of them, and there is the ecliptic as well. With the animations which I offer, you can see clearly this, and even we can wash out the sky so that you can have completely dark sky, so you can see what we're talking about. Well, you can't see it in a real life. Is the Sun is passing throughout different sky. Watch out this Ophiuchus, this constellation. And it's quite a different than the normally we know as a zodiacal constellations. You can see in some constellation the Sun is taking little time, in some constellation quite a big time. So it's not even a whole month like in the zodiac. You see Virgo, it's quite a big constellation, takes a lot of time. While in the Scorpio, it's only 5 days. And we finish in this strange constellation, which is not in the zodiacal signs, of Ophiuchus, or the Snake Bearer. This system came from the erroneous geocentric model, where the Earth is in the center. And then you've got, you can read it, the septem orbis, or the seven circles. And then you can see near the letter septem, via solis, or the way of the Sun. This is when the Sun, where the Sun is rotating. The Sun is turning around the Earth according to this system. And this is the Ptolemaical system. It's this is the accepted system in a zodiacal system, or an astrology, that all the planets and all the heavenly bodies are turning around the Earth, and the universe is finished with the sphere of the immovable stars. This red line is actually the end of the universe. After this universe, after this, on this red circle, glued, so to say, the stars, and we see them like a sphere. Behind it, there is nothing. There is nothing. And when the Sun is moving throughout all of these different signs, this is what zodiacal sign you may have, but now there is a serious flaws in zodiacal and this astrological system, simply because first thing, it takes the date of the birth for calculation of what zodiacal sign you have. While the argument is that the human being is alive even in a womb, so how come that the stars will exercise some mystical influence immediately after the birth, but not before the birth, where the fetus is alive and kicking. How come that they don't exercise no influence on it while in the womb of the mother, but as soon as the baby gets born, then the influence started. Second thing is that it accepts the wrong Ptolemaic system, that all the heavenly bodies are rotating around the sun. Third, it accepts the wrong view that all the stars are in a screen around us, like in a sphere around us. Like we actually see the sky. And as we saw with all the animations we saw in the different pictures, we showed the lion and the scorpion. You saw that the stars are not actually in the same plane, though they look in the same plane at night. They are not. Now the point is that if the stars exercise some kind of influence, obviously the ones that are near to us will have more influence than the ones that are farther from us. So if we know certain constellation as being in just two-dimensional, but it's actually three-dimensional, we need to take into account the distance, the depth of the stars, actually the distance between the stars each other in comparison to the Earth. So the constellation in the sky, the constellations in the sky, the zodiac and the whole heaven is going to look much different if we know the distance and if we take them into the account. So this is another unscientific thing. Then another point why we should never believe in astrology is that the astrology's predictions before 18th century never took into the account the major influence of the two planets which are discovered after that. You see the pale blue Uranus, which is discovered by Sir William Herschel in 1781, and the bluish, the dark bluish Neptune, which is discovered by the French astronomer Le Verrier in 1846. So they are never taken into account before this date, and if they are never taken into account, and they are quite big planets, they are 50 times bigger than the Earth, how come that much smaller planet, say for example the planet Mars, which is 10 times smaller than the Earth, can be taken into account, but the planet which is 50 times bigger than the Earth, like Uranus and Neptune, are not taken into account in astrological predictions, simply because nobody knew about them before their discovery? So all of the astrological predictions before this date is simply false. Another point is that because of the recession of the Earth, that means the moving of the axis of the Earth towards the skies, the polar star is not always polaris, is moving and is recessing. In the result of this, the constellations are changing where the sun is going to move. That means the ecliptic, the red line that shows on the picture. Now they said it's a 12 constellations. Now there is another one coming into being, Ophiuchus. And the sun spends quite substantial time in the constellation of Ophiuchus. Also, at the time where the sun enters and the sun exits, the constellations are not the same as in the time of Ptolemaeus because of this recession. So now it's not 22nd to 22nd, but quite a different days because of this recession. That means all the zodiacal signs are fully confused, and you can't trust them because they simply don't take into account the precession. This is how you're going to see in the 12th of August 2012, the sun is going to be in Ophiuchus, but in the time of Ptolemy, say 12th of August 150, you're going to see it in Sagittarius. So the astrology using the system of Ptolemaeus is using just the wrong system. And in this way, if anything is based on the wrong system, it's going to have a wrong prediction. So the people that believe in the astrology, they believe just in the wrong system. Another strange thing why we should never believe astrology is how come that every 12 person or 600,000 of the humankind having the same zodiacal sign will have identical destiny and so on. That's absolute nonsense. Even the modern psychology cannot classify the variety of human characters and temperaments in much broader view, how much less in the 12 simple categories. Also, astrology is a way of living. Many people write books and write articles to the newspapers about the zodiacal sign, and in this way they make their money. And they're living. All Greeks deified the heavenly bodies. Actually, they gave them the names of their gods: Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, and Uranus, Mercury, and Venus. All of them are pagan gods. Some of them try to marry the zodiacal science, astrology, with the Christianity. Should never be done, because one is a pagan invention bearing the signs of the pagan gods, and the other one is a divine invention, and should never be mixed both of them. Obviously, when Christ comes, these names have to be changed, because I don't think that all people in the new earth and in the new heaven gonna tolerate pagan names. By the way, the church tried to change them, and the names of the some constellations, they try to change them, but even calling the moon Saint Mary, and the stars with the different names, like Venus, they were calling John the Baptist. But then became even worse than before, because how can you say that Saint Mary occulted some kind of star, or Saint Mary set, or Saint Mary rise, and John the Baptist set down, or John the Baptist makes transit, and all of these things? It looks like a blasphemy, and the system wasn't accepted very well. Also, another important point what we should realize in astrology is that the prediction and reality doesn't coincide. The fulfillment of astrology's predictions is only 2%, but people prefer to believe this 2%. So they make a certain prediction, and the reality, that means what is being fulfilled, is only 2%. On this graphic, you can see the red overlapping of the circles. Now the fulfillment and the prediction is completely different stories. Only 2% coincide, and the reality and the fulfillment are very asymmetrical toward the prediction. That means 2% are not symmetrical to 90%, to 98%. So this is a strange thing. How can people can believe 2% but ignore 98% wrong data? If you have a friend where he promised to come to your house, or promised to give you anything, or promised to do something, and he does this 2 out of 100 times, and he lies to you 98 times out of 100, you're gonna drop him as a friend, as a completely unreliable. But strange that the people keep on believing astrology, though the astrology gives them wrong information and wrong predictions 98% of the time. On top of that, you must think about that astrology robs the people of their responsibility, and talking about personal responsibility, of the stars and the planets are guilty because today you've got a bad mood. What's your responsibility? Nothing. You blame the stars for it. So you're shifting the responsibility, and you became like an animal. Animals are not responsible of their behavior. Nobody drags to court the lion because he ate the antelope, which happens to be a mother, and the baby is gonna starve to death, because nobody holds the animals responsible. In the same way, the people became like animals when they shift their responsibility to other factors, being such external factors like the stars. We should rather believe in the one that holds the stars, that's God, than the stars itself, because it's utter nonsense to watch in such an unscientific thing. The size of the universe is incredible. If you look at the different heavenly bodies and see their sizes, it's just amazing how big the things can go. And this is stars and planets. Think about galaxies and clusters of galaxies. We're talking about big numbers. This is how the Earth looks compared to Venus. It's almost identical to sizes. This is Neptune near the Earth. So it's about 50 times bigger than the Earth. Look how the Earth gets dwarfed. Then Neptune compared to Saturn without the ring. And then Saturn compared to Jupiter. And Jupiter compared to our Sun, it's about 1,000 times smaller, Jupiter, than the Sun. Then Sirius, the brightest star in the sky, Sirius. You can see how the things get smaller and smaller and smaller than the previous, though we consider them quite big. Arcturus in the constellation of Bootes. Quite a big star, but again it's been dwarfed by Rigel in Orion. There is a Betelgeuse again in Orion, a red giant. Antares in Scorpio. See, can't even see the Sun now, it's so dwarfed. Can you imagine what big stars are those? Mucifei, or the granite star in Cepheid. In Cepheus, it's one of the biggest stars. There is a bigger star than this discovered in the Canis Major. I didn't put them yet because after a few years we're going to have another and another star. Just want to give you a few ideas how the things can be big. If you put this star in the middle of the solar system, that means in the place of the Sun, it's going to take the orbit of Jupiter, and it's gonna reach the orbit of Saturn. It's such a big star, and this is actually a scheme of a galaxy. This is where the Sun should be. Nobody has seen this. This is why it's scheme. It's not a picture, because in order you to see the galaxy, you need to be out of the galaxy. We never been. Human beings has never been out of the solar system, and to the nearest star, which is only 4 light years away, how much more out of the galaxy can you imagine? But this is where the Sun should be, and this is also a very special place. You can watch different videos, like the privileged planet, where you can see why a Sun and our solar system and even our Earth has such a privileged place in the universe, which allows us to contemplate All of these wonders, and to admire all of what God hands has created. And you can get more information on that video and many more videos which you can get. But our place is actually really very, very special. We were quite in the middle of the galaxy. First, the sky is going to be washed out by the sky, by the manifold stars. Actually, there wouldn't be a much difference between the day and night, because it's such intense light all around. We wouldn't be able to see anything, and there is going to be no sense in the cosmic observations there. While in this place, you can see clearly. The night sky and the stars and many other phenomena. So our position in the universe and in the galaxy is again a product of design and not product of chance. Also, if you were in the middle, because of the high radiation, the life could become easily extinct. While at the position where we are, the radiation is not so high. So that's what it is. The furthest object you can see with the naked eye is the galaxy of Andromeda, or M31, by the catalog of Messier, and you can see it actually with naked eye in the quiet night in the constellation of in a moonless night in the constellation of Andromeda. In a big telescope, it looks quite magnificent. It's a quite a big. It takes quite a lot of space in a sky. So if you take also a long exposure picture with your camera sticked on a telescope, you can have a nice view as well. It's the nearest galaxy to us. It's only 2.5 million light years. It's double the size of our galaxy. Our galaxy is approximately 100,000 light years across, and contains 200 billion stars, while Andromeda is between 200 and 400,000 light years across, and contains up to 2 trillion stars, and it's bigger than our galaxy. It actually travels toward us. If we look at the Great Bear, the Ursa Major, we can see a galaxy which looks flat out towards us, and this galaxy is 21 million light years. You can start seeing the spot there, which is going to be turned like the galaxy. 21 million light years away from us. It's called the Pinwheel Galaxy. It's looking straight towards. We're looking at the pole of the galaxy, looking flat. This is how it looks through a Hubble telescope. Of course, this kind of pictures you can get only with permission of NASA. With the normal telescope, you can have a significant and beautiful view, but not so crisp clear like this ones. The Great Bear has also double stars and things that you can actually test your eyes, like the second star from the handle of the Big Dipper. It's called Al-Khor and Mitza, or in Arabic that means the horse and the rider. And if you can be able to see the stars, your eyes is sufficient to be a rider on a horse, or to be accepted in a Arabic cavalry. And this is how it looks. Actually, not a double star. It's five stars which are gravitationally bound towards each other. You can see them on this animation. You can see a few of them, of course, not all. The constellation of Lyra, You can also see a double star, which turns to be a quadruple star. Actually, most of the stars in the galaxy are double or triple or quadruple stars. Our sun is kind of exception. You can see these two stars, each of them in turn. This is called the double-double star in the constellation of Lyra, which is beautifully seen from the northern hemisphere. Each one of them is also a double star, which you're going to see now if we take a travel towards them. In the constellation of Lyra, you can see another beautiful nebula. The nebulas can be quite beautiful and quite nice and spectacular to watch. In this one, this is called the Ring Nebula. It can be seen in a moderately big telescope. There is a Ring Nebula. You can see the different colors, a result of radiation of different elements, the red being the hydrogen and the green oxygen. It's 2,300 light years from us and is 2.6 light years across. That's actually the breadth of a star when the star breathes out and pushes its outer coating. That's a quite a big and quite beautiful a nebula. This is how it looks in the telescope. In the middle you can see the white spot. That's the remnants of the star. And this is how you're gonna see the same nebula with the infrared lights. You can see it's like almost like a flower, like a desert flower. It looks beautiful in the infrared lights. In the constellation of Draco, there is another nebula. It's called the Cat Eye Nebula. You're gonna see why many people see significant symbols for Christians or non-Christians in the nebula, but the sizes of the galaxy and the sizes of the universe offer different shapes and different kinds. And if you want to watch something and you want to see it, you can see it. They saw a face in a Mars even, but you know, you can't check up everything to look into your liking. This is the Cat Eye Nebula. It's 3,000 light years and is 0.4 light years across. It's, as I say, 3,300 light years from us in the constellation of Draco. It looks like an eye, really. And this is how you're going to look at it in a telescope. Of course, space telescope like Hubble. Interesting point is in the constellation of Hercules. There is a star cluster, a globular star cluster, which is 25,000 light years from us. It means the light will travel from there 25,000 years. It's a huge cluster. Yes, this cluster has a diameter of 145 light years. If you are in one of the stars in the cluster, especially one of the middle stars, you're gonna see stars all over you at night. It's gonna be it's not gonna be maybe a night like we have here. You're gonna have only big bright stars all around you, in the bigger maybe than Venus in brightness, and brighter than Venus. The cluster can be seen with naked eye if you've got very strong vision. With the normal binoculars even you can see it. This is the globular cluster in Hercules. This is what's seen if you look at it through the telescope.
just star near star, star near star. The interesting thing is that in 1974, in Puerto Rico, Arecibo telescope, a radio telescope, sent a message, the Arecibo message, where in the top part, the white little square shows the numbers from 1 to 10, then the structure of the DNA, a picture of a man, as you can see the red picture, and the picture of the telescope, down the pink one. Obviously, until the message reaches the cluster of Hercules, the cluster is going to move into quite different place. The point wasn't to have a communication with them, because we have to wait 50,000 years until the message comes there and if they reply quickly to them to return back. It's not that the point. The point is to test the new telescope which was given there, and to throw a message into the universe. Voyager, 3 years later, in 1977, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 made a disc called The Sounds of the Earth, where it shows, as you can see on the back side of the disc, it shows the distance and the situation of the solar system, certain basics about humankind, as well as the different voices. Also the Bulgarian voice of Valia Balkanska also is there. And different sounds are there. This travels, again, it doesn't travel to a specific destination. It will reach a star in the constellation of Ophiuchus in quite a long time, maybe 30,000 years. The problem is just to have, like Carl Sagan put it, to throw a bottle in the ocean of the space. And the humankind always want to reach the extraterrestrials and to have a communication with them. Though the Bible says that the extraterrestrials exist, the planets and the stars in our galaxy and in out all universe, most of them could be inhabited, and the Bible says that all the intelligent beings in the planets where they live around the universe doesn't have the same problem which we experience, and that is the moral problem. That means they have not been steeped into the sin, so they live much happier and holy life than what we do. And when Jesus returns, he's gonna bring us into together with them, so we're gonna see them and be able to communicate at that stage. So this is what the Bible says. In the constellation of Taurus, the bull, you can see a quite significant star which exploded in the year 154. This is the remnants of the explosion you can see today. It's 6,500 light years away from us. The distance between both ends is 11 light years. And Chinese, Japanese astronomers and Arabic astronomers recorded this, though not European, because at this stage this was taken as a bad omen, maybe, and nobody took note in Europe literature of that. And this is the remains of supernova, which could have been seen back in 11th century for days, even during the day, and was quite significant thing to see. Constellation of Orion is another beautiful sight. It's actually one of the easiest constellations you can see. Some German astronomers wanted to call it constellation Napoleon, trying to flatter Napoleon, but even French astronomers rejected the idea. And it's called, still today, it's called Orion. In this Orion, you've got the Orion Nebula, And if we have to take a travel to that, it will take us 130, 300, 100 and 300 light years to travel to that if you travel with the speed of light. It's interesting because the constellation of Orion, it's placed on a heavenly equator. That means that can be seen from every point of the Earth, even from the northern and from the southern pole. Every point of the Earth can be seen, this constellation. We're approaching this nebula. This nebula is quite a big nebula. It's 24 light years across. I've got a few bright stars in the middle. It's with the modest telescope you can watch it and you can see it. Though no, in not in such a beautiful colors like it's here. This is how Hubble saw it. Interesting that this constellation is mentioned in the Bible several times. In the book of Job, when God talks to Job, he says to him in the book of Job 38:31, he says, "Canst thou bind the sweet influences of Pleiades or loose the bands of Orion?" Of course, Pleiades and Orion are later inserted in the Bible. The Bible uses the Hebrew words for Pleiades is Kima, and for the Orion Kessil. Interestingly, the Orion in Greek, Orion the hunter, it's also in Hebrew is also it meaning the strong one. The strong one. Its meaning is also a picture of a man, like in Greek tradition. You can see this nebula magnified. You can see the four stars in the middle, bluish star, and this is how it looks in the if it's magnified. Very interesting. Ellen G. White in Vision saw this constellation having a significant point to do, a significant point, significant role to play in the second coming. She says in the Christian Experience of Ellen G. White, she says, "So in December 16, 1848, the Lord gave me a view of the shaking of the powers of the heavens. I saw that when the Lord says heaven in giving the signs recorded by Matthew, Mark, and Luke, he meant heaven, and when he said earth, he meant earth. The powers of heaven and are the sun, moon, and stars. They rule in heavens. The powers of earth are those that rule on the earth. The powers of heaven will be shaken at the voice of God. Then the sun, moon, and the stars will be moved by their places. They will not pass away, but be shaken by the voice of God. Dark, heavy clouds came up and clashed against each other. The atmosphere parted and rolled back. Then we could look up through the open space in Orion, whence we came the voice of God. The holy city will come down through that open space. I saw that the powers of the earth are now being shaken and that events come in order. War and rumors and war, sword and famine and pestilence are first to shake the powers of the earth. And then the voice of God will shake the sun, moon, and stars, and this earth also. I saw that the shaking of the powers of Europe is not, as some teach, the shaking of the powers of heaven, but it is the shaking of the angry nations. The southern sky also offers beautiful views. In the constellation of the cross, you can see the jewel box. It's also open cluster. You can see the orange star in the middle, surrounded by bluish stars. In the constellation of Centaurus, you can see the Omega Centauri. It's also a globular cluster that can be seen with naked eye. It's actually bigger than the moon. You can see it with naked eye, though it's dim. You need the moonless light, and the night free of pollution. And the telescope can be seen beautifully. Also, there is Centaurus A. There is a galaxy, and in Centaurus that you can also see through the telescope. though not in such bright colors like here. In the southern hemisphere, you can see the nearest satellites of our galaxy. Two sister galaxies, the Small and the Big Magellanic Cloud, as can be seen here. The other beauties like Eta Carinae Nebula, as can be seen here, which is also quite big and can be seen with naked eye. N3532, a beautiful view open cluster again, it can be seen on the sky with the binoculars even, it's a beautiful sight. This is inside Eta Carinae. It's 7,500 light years away from us and is almost the size of the solar system. This nebula result again of star that ejects material. Ellen G. White also had a view of other worlds. After we see all of these heavenly beauties, let's turn to her writings. She says, "The Lord has given me a view of other worlds. Wings were given me, and an angel attended me from the city to a place that was given, that was bright and glorious. The grass of the place was living green, and the birds were warbled in sweet song. The inhabitants of the place were all sizes. They were noble, majestic, and lovely. They bore the express image of Jesus, and their countenances beamed with holy joy, expressive of the freedom and happiness of the place. I asked one of them why they were so much more lovely than those on the earth. The reply was, we are lived in a strict obedience by the commandments of God, and we have not fallen by disobedience like those on the earth. Then I saw two trees. One looked much like the tree of life in the city. The fruit of both looked beautiful, but the one they could not eat. They had power to eat of both, but they were forbidden to eat of one. Then my attending angel said to me, none of these in this place have tasted of the forbidden tree, but if they should eat, they would fall. Then I was taken to a world which had seven moons. There I saw a good old eunuch who had been translated. On this right arm he wore a glorious palm, and on the each leaf was written victory. Around his head was a dazzling white red, and leaves of the red, and in the middle of the each leaf was written purity, and around the red was stones of various colors that shone brighter than the stars, and cast a reflection upon the letters and magnified them. On the back part of his head was a bow that confined the red, and upon the bow was written holiness. Above the red was a lovely crown that shone brighter than the sun. I asked him if this was the place he was taken to from the earth. He says, it is not. The city is my home, and I have come to visit this place. He moved about the place as if perfectly at home. I begged of my attending angel to let me remain in that place. I could not bear the thought of coming back to this dark world again. Then the angel said, you must go back, and if you are faithful, you, with the 144,000, shall have the privilege of visiting all the worlds and viewing the handiwork of God. So if all of this will come, let's read a final verse from the Bible. But the day of the Lord, 2 Peter 3, verse 10 to 13, will come as a thief in the night, and in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat, and the earth also and the world that are therein shall be burnt up. Seeing that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought to be you in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of the God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and the new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Thank you for your attention, and may God bless you to continue contemplating the wonders of God and worship him as a creator.